Let us praise his name. He is worthy to be praised from the uprising of the sun to the going down. And our hearts have been lifted up already for the praise of his holy day. At this time, you look in your bulletin, see where the call to worship. God be in all praise. Let us look there and we'll repeat. I'll do the first verse, congregation the second, and we'll do the last one together. God be on all praising, we worship you today and sing the love amazing that song cannot repay. We lift our hearts before you and wait upon your word together. Amen. At this time, we'll repeat Exodus 20, verse 8 to 11, and St. John chapter 3, verse 16 and 17 together. Remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou nor thy son, nor thy daughter, nor thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is in thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heaven, the earth, the sea, and all that in them is, and rested on the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not his Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through him might be saved. Amen.
And that's why we sing 214, We Have This Hope.
Pray. Our great God and Father of the universe, we are thankful to you this morning that you have given us this hope that is still burning in our hearts. We pray, God, that you'll help us by your grace to cherish this hope and to look forward to that great day when our hope will be realized. Keep us then faithful and true to you as we worship you today, in Jesus' name.
Amen.
I am weak, but thou'rt strong. Jesus keeps me from all wrong. I'll be satisfied as long as I walk, let me walk close to thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Grant us, Jesus, this is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Through this world of toil and snares, if I falter, Lord, who cares? Who will me that burden share? None but thee, dear Lord, none but thee. Just a closer walk with thee. Grant us, Jesus, hears my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be. Well, my feeble life is o'er, and time for me will be no more. Guide me gently, safely home to thy kingdom shore, to thy shore. Just a closer walk with thee. Grant, O Jesus, hears my plea. Daily walking close to thee.
I want you to sing the chorus for me if you can. I'd be so happy.
Just a closer walk with thee. Grant us, Jesus, this is my plea. Daily walking close to thee. Let it be, dear Lord, let it be.
Thank you.
Pastor, let us stand and turn to 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 9 through 13. 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 9 through 13. We will read responsively. 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 9 through 13. Verse 9 says, "The Lord is not slight concerning his promise, as some men count slightness, but is long-suffering to usward, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance.
But the day of the Lord will come as a thief in the night, in the which the heavens shall pass away with great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. The earth also and the works that therein shall be burnt up.
Seeing then that all these things shall be dissolved, what manner of person ought ye to be in all holy conversations and godliness?
Looking for and hastening unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heaven and fire shall be dissolved, and the element shall melt with firmament."
Altogether, nevertheless, we are called unto his promise, look for a new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. May the Lord add a blessing to the reading, the hearing, the understanding, and the application of his word.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Thank you. At this time, we're going to pray. I ask that as you kneel, as you bow your knees, that most importantly, that we will bow our hearts before the high and powerful and mighty God. If you cannot kneel, we ask that you sit reverently where you are. And let us petition the throne of grace. Let us kneel for prayer. Let us pray. Great God, Creator of heaven and earth, sustainer of all things, the God who speak and it is done, the God who command and it stood fast, the God who holds the water in the hollowed palm of your hand, the God of Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, Daniel, Emmanuel, God, my God. We come to you this afternoon, Almighty God, recognizing that we would have sinned and have come short of your glory. And Lord, we approach your mercy throne, Almighty God, recognizing that there is nothing good in us. But it's because of your Son, Jesus Christ, who was bled and died on Calvary's tree. And for that, Lord, we are eternally grateful. And so, Lord, we confess that we have sinned. We have heard. Lord, we would have not done the thing that you would have called us to do. Lord, we would have speak, Lord, words that you would not have want us to speak. Lord, we would have gone place that you would not have want us to go. And we confessed with our lips. Loving Father, as we come to you through your Son, Jesus Christ of Nazareth, Lord, there are people among us who are sick and afflicted. Lord, we are thankful that earth has no sorrow that heaven cannot heal. And so, divine God, whatever the challenges that your people are facing this afternoon, we ask, Almighty God, that you will take absolute control. Lord, it is you who said that we should cast all our cares upon you because you care for us. And so, Lord, we are casting our sicknesses, we are casting our hopelessness, we are casting our frustration, we are casting everything we have, Almighty God, on you, because we know you care for us, and you will do for us, Lord, that which we ask. And so, Lord, we come before you this afternoon, Lord, knowing that you are all great, you are almighty, you are all powerful. There is nothing hidden from your eyes, Almighty God. And so, Lord, we know that you see through us. And so, Lord, we ask that you will root up everything in us that dishonor you. Lord, we know that we have not been loving the way you have called us to love. Lord, we have not been showing compassion the way you have called us to. Lord, we ask for forgiveness. We ask, divine God, that you will teach us to love, that, Lord, you will teach us to show compassion, that you will teach us to be kind one towards each other. Yes. Loving Father, we present the community of pioneers in your hand. Lord, the community belongs to you because you said in your word, the earth is the Lord and the fullness thereof, the world and they that dwell therein. And so, divine God, we ask that you will go into this community, Almighty God, and prepare the hearts of those who are in this community. But Lord, we ask that you will prepare us first and foremost with the anointing power of the Holy Spirit that we can go. Loving Father, I pray that you will have your perfect will in us. Lord, that you will come down and be so close to us through the anointing power of the Holy Spirit that our lives will never be the same again. I pray, divine God, that you will go into the homes through the medium of the internet, Lord, and that you will speak to some broken hearts, that you will speak to some broken marriage, that you will speak to some hopeless cases, because divine God, you speak to dry bones and dry bones come alive. So he asks, divine God, that you will speak to some dry circumstances this afternoon, and we know that there will be life. I pray, divine God, that Emmanuel, God with us, will recognize that you are with us, and that, Lord, we will see your character, we will see your glory, and divine God, we will perform and we will act and we will behave as according to the high and holy and mighty God you are. Lord, I pray that you will speak to the speaker. Lord, that his word will not be his, but it will be through the anointing power of the Holy Spirit that he will speak this afternoon. Lord, I pray that you will wrap the word that leave his lips with the anointing power of the Holy Spirit. I pray, divine God, that it will meet some iron heart, some heart of stone, and it will smash them to pieces and plant some hearts of flesh, divine God, so we can grow in the knowledge and in the fullness of your love, your mercy, and your grace. Lord, sanctify the speaker that he will use. Sanctify the microphone, the microphone. Sanctify the atmosphere so that, Lord, will be drawn divinely close to you, that all of us will be saved in your kingdom and those in whom you will lead us to witness to. In Jesus' name, amen.
Life is easy when you're up on the mountain and you've got peace of mind like you've never known. But things change when you're down in the valley. But don't lose faith, for you're never alone. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, he'll make them right. And the God of the good times is still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God in the night. You talk of faith when you're up on the mountain, but talk comes easy when life's at its best.
Now it's down in the valley of trials and temptations. That's where your faith is really put to the test. For the God on the mountain is still God in the valley. When things go wrong, He'll make them right. And the God of the good times is still God in the bad times. The God of the day is still God in the night. The God of the day is still God in the night. The God of the day is still God in the night. Thank you.
Every time I hear Brother Boone's voice, I become somewhat fearful. I don't know why I did this, but the first time I heard him sing, I fall in love with a singing voice. And somehow you have heard me speak, and he told me that he would love to be at the service that I'll be preaching. And so we have connected. And today I'm grateful to you, Brother Boone, for being here with us today. Amen. Worshiping. You have touched one of my key songs. He's still God of the mountain. He's still God in the valley. When things go wrong, He will make them right. I've been trying to sing. I think I sung that song one time. I went to preach somewhere, and I tried to sing it, and I think I did well. I'm going to somehow try to do it again, because I had it. It must have been in another Bible that I have. But I had the words. I had the words somewhere. And I'm going to keep practicing. And I know one of these days I'm going to be perfect. One of these days I'm just going to sing a song and then that's it. We had worship since morning. We had worship and we could just say the benediction. When Brother Lewis was praying, he says afternoon, and I'm saying, it's time to go. But we got to spend a little longer time in God's house as we come to linger a little longer with Him. He promised that He will never leave us nor forsake us. And so this is the Holy Sabbath. And so we come to worship Him, and I'm sure that there is something that He has prepared for us today. He has always been doing that. Preparing to give us something that we are in need of. And so today I trust that as we come into the house of the Lord, we come to learn about Jesus. And when we leave here, we depart to go and serve. Amen. That's our main duty. Come here to learn of Him. Then we depart to serve. We serve a mighty God. Awesome God. God of love. One of the songs that Brother Boone touched on was Just a Closer Walk. Every day we have to find ourselves having a closer walk with the God that we serve. And when we keep walking with him closer and closer, then we are going to reach the place where, like Enoch, he's going to say, don't worry, go back home. Don't worry, go back home. I think that's what Enoch did in his walking with God. He walked so close on a daily basis that God says, look here, man, you come too close to my house. It's easier for you to just come home with me. And so that's where we want to reach. Walk with God closely here so he can take us finally home to be with him. And so every day with Jesus got to be sweeter than the day before. You know what was what has done last year, 2016? We got to do more in 2017 because we are nearing home, nearer to home. So if I preach for an hour, then I expect two this time. I'm not making that kind of promise, but God knows what his people need, when we need it, and how to get it to them. So I give thanks to God for bringing his people together this morning where we can come to worship him. And those who worship by online, welcome to the worship hour of Emmanuel Church. Trust that your souls will be blessed as we join together on this holy Sabbath for worship. I would invite you to bow your heads with me. Gracious Father and our God, we thank you so much for this wonderful privilege. Pray now that you will take away our bent to sinning and you will allow the whole rugged cross to be the center of our viewing this morning. That Jesus will be uplifted, honored, praised, and glorified because it is through him that we have salvation. Pray, God, that the cross will be so big this morning that I'll be lost sight of and the cross will be in view. So Jesus can be seen, be known, and be heard. Speak through me, Heavenly Father, and may your Holy Spirit do the work that is to be done in the heart of your children. May we leave this place, Father in heaven, rejoicing because we are going home. Thanks again for hearing and answering my prayer, I pray in Jesus' name. I want to be ready when Jesus comes. I want to be ready when Jesus comes. Earth's pleasures grow dim while I'm waiting for him. Lord, keep me till Jesus comes. In this world we are living in, so many things are happening. And while we are waiting for Jesus to come, it takes something to be ready. Do we really want Jesus to come? Do we really want Jesus to come? Whether we want him to come, yes or no, he's going to come. Whether we are ready for him to come, yes or no, he's going to come. When we look in our world today, There are lots of developments that are taking place. But do these happenings appeal to us? Things might be raising. You go to buy some things and you don't even know that prices have been going up, because sometimes we don't really notice them. Because sometimes we are just buying. But does the everyday happening around us, the prices of things that rolls up, really appeals to us? I've been to places where I've seen people in long stretch of lines waiting. Long lines waiting to get through with something or the other. But is the church of God waiting so eagerly for Jesus to come? For centuries, the church has been teaching that Jesus will return. But there are some serious questions that we need to ponder while waiting for Jesus to come. How many of us expect that Jesus will come before you die? Serious. How many of us believe that Jesus is going to come by 2020? It's now 2017. We approach first month. This is last Sabbath. So thank God we have complete a month. Still not finished. It's just the 28th. So we have a few more days to go. But thank God he has kept us through 2016. And we owe it all to him for bringing us safely through to a new year, 2017. This is the last Sabbath I said that we must be thankful that God has brought us this far. How many of us want Jesus to come now? Now, how many of us want Jesus to come now? Not many of us would want Jesus to come now, because we have unfinished business to take care of. Apparently, some of us want some more money. Some of us might need a wife. Some might need a husband. Some might need so many things that we might say we want. But we need to realize that this world doesn't have much to offer any longer. No matter what we have in this world, it's going to go. It's going to go. But then, what would be our reaction if we know that Jesus is going to come this year, this very year? What's going to be your reaction? What would be your reaction? You know, a little boy was asked, "Son, it's a long time we heard that Jesus is coming, but we don't know when. If you know that he's going to come X time, what would you do?" He says, "Well, I just get ready." Because he's coming next week, so I get ready to meet him next week. But it's the question asked to him, if you know that you were told that he's coming, but you don't know when he's going to come, what would you do? And so he declared that he would get ready and stay ready. Because after all, I don't know when he's going to come. So he can come anytime. So the best thing for me to do is to get ready and stay ready. So he can come and find me waiting. And I think that's the attitude that we should have in waiting and in preparation for Jesus to come. From the book Christ's Object Lesson, the servant of the Lord says that it's the privilege of every Christian not only to look for, but to hasten the coming of the day of Christ. Not only to look for, we are looking forward to that glorious day when Jesus is going to come. But it is our privilege. We are privileged enough not only to be looking forward to that day, but to hastening unto the coming of that great and glorious day when Jesus will come. But beloved, before Jesus comes, however, the church must be ready. The good old song says it's a glorious church without spot, without wrinkle, being washed in the blood of the Lamb. And so when I ask, or the songwriter may ask the question, are you ready for Jesus to come? Have you been to Jesus for the cleansing power? Are you washed in the blood of the Lamb? Then the answer must, can be, or should be, yes. I am redeemed, but not with silver. I am bought, but not with gold, but with the precious blood of Jesus Christ, precious Savior, seems untold. Our answer need to be yes. I've been to the fountain that was filled with blood, drawn from Emmanuel's vein. As a sinner, I've plunged beneath that flood and lose all my guilt and my stain. Yes, redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through his infinite mercy. His child. His child. And forever I am. We got to be his child now and forever. So we are waiting and we are watching for him. We get ready and we are staying ready because we are his child. We are his children today. So we have on our ready garment. Ready garment. Wrapped up and tied up and tangled up in Jesus Christ. It's a glorious church without spot, without wrinkle, washed in the blood of the Lamb. But I want to say to us, beloved, it's not the four corners of the wall but that must be washed. We talk about church. I'm saying it's a glorious church, a church without spot or wrinkle or any such thing. Not the four corners of this wall, but you and I. That must be washed in the blood of the Lamb and be ready for Jesus to come. I hear Paul says in Romans chapter 12, how must I as a member of God's church get ready to meet him? How must I as a member of God's church? We are all members of the body of Christ, and I must be ready. Paul says, I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice. Holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. So, it is a complete, total surrender. How must I be ready? Surrender myself. Total surrender. We sing the song, all to Jesus I surrender. All to him I freely give. I will ever love and trust him in his presence daily live. But I'm wondering sometimes if we really give all. Because Jesus expect to get all or none at all. And so sometimes it would appear as if we are offering him off. Off to Jesus, I surrender. He's not going to accept that at all. Sometimes I think we are playing hopscotch with him. In the river and the bank. Sometimes we are in the river, we are on the bank. We are on this side and we are... It's either we are on the bank or we are in the river with Jesus. We can't be off in the river and the bank. We must have to be in total surrender to him. Then verse 2 of the passage says, and be not conformed to this world. So we surrender to Jesus, our all. Is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Does your all the Spirit control? You can only be blessed and have peace and sweet rest as we heal to him our body and our soul. So it's a total surrender to him. And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Jesus says that the world is not going to love you. He that gathereth with me scattereth abroad. He that is not with me is against me. He came to this world and the world did not like him. For what reason, I can't tell. Because he didn't do anything for the world to hate him. But he says, if they hated me, then they will hate you for following me. And from the fact that the world hates Jesus so bitterly that the world was killed, then the world's going to hate us by following Jesus. Just following Jesus. If we are lover of Jesus, then we can't be popular. There got to be something different about the followers of Jesus Christ. So once we surrender to him, our all, then we can't be the same again. We are not our own. We are not our own. I hear the psalmist David says, in Psalm 50, somewhere about Psalm 50, I think it's verse 5 or 6. Psalm 50. I think here the psalmist David says something here that I like very much in connection with what Paul says. I think he says, gather my saints together unto me. Is that the passage? Gather my saints together unto me. Those that have made a covenant with me by sacrifice. So once we accept Jesus as our Lord and Savior for our lives, and we surrender our all to him, we are now called saints of God. Saints of God, lift up your voices. And as saints of God, he says to David, gather my saints together unto me. That's why we are together here this morning. We gather together to ask the Lord's blessing. He chastened and hastened his will to make known. The wicked oppressing, cease from distressing. Sing praises to his name, because God forgets not his own. And so we are here this morning, gathering ourselves together in the covenant by sacrifice to worship God in the beauty of holiness. And he promised that he's going to bless us abundantly. I hear Paul says in the book of Ephesians, he is willing and ready to do far more exceeding abundantly than which we are able to even ask or think. That's the God we serve. He does not hold back anything when he's giving. He gave everything. Second thing that we need to do to be ready for Jesus to come is to have a concern for the souls for whom Christ died. Have a concern for the souls for whom Christ, you know, we don't love the soul of people. Sometimes it appears as if we don't even love our own soul. Because if we love our own soul, then we will be seeking to save our souls. We'll be doing everything to see to it that I'm saving God's kingdom. Because you can't save somebody unless you are saved. So got to put out every effort. A concerted effort to save yourself. You're on a ship and the ship is sinking. Who are you going to try to save? The pilot? And you are in danger as well? You're going to try to save yourself. A matter of fact, in the airplane you're flying, they tell you that should anything happen, oxygen mask going to drop. And you must take and make sure that you put on your one first. You got to put on your one first, because you got to see to it that you are in a position to be saved so you can help somebody to be saved. And so we got to have a concern for ourselves. Yes, that's one of the way of being selfish. Saving yourself, because you got to save yourself. But you're not selfish enough that you're going to just save yourself and you alone being saved. That's too selfish. But you save yourself in order to save somebody. You know, Jesus could have saved himself. Jesus could have very well saved himself when they slapped him, when they spat upon him, when they bore his side with the Roman spike, telling him, "Come down if you are the Son of God, and save yourself and us." He could have saved himself. But he did not save himself. He determined that he's going to save his children. Amen. And so we got to have a concern for people. God loves people more than anything. Love what God loves. Book Desire of Ages. I love to read these books. Page 633. And it is our privilege to hasten that coming. It is our privilege to hasten that coming. Today I'm giving the gospel a certain sound. It is our privilege to hasten that coming. By giving the gospel to the world, it is in our power to hasten our Lord's return. Jesus should have come long time ago. But the church has been holding back the preaching of the gospel. One of these days, the preaching of the gospel soon be over. Sooner we are going to be done with the troubles of this world. But the gospel must be lived first and foremost and proclaimed to earth remotest bound so Jesus can come. And so it is in our power to hasten our Lord's return. We are not only to look for, but to hasten the coming of the day of God. God will do the work if we would furnish him with instruments. So we are all here today. We are called to be instruments of God's peace. Instruments in his hands to be used by him to proclaim the gospel of the kingdom so Jesus can come to take his people home to live with him eternally. Beloved, there seemed to be a delay in the coming of Christ. Because it's a long time we have been teaching, preaching, and living that Jesus is coming. But we haven't seen him come yet. Is a delay in the coming of Christ, then what is causing that delay? We have just sung earlier on that the signs foretold in the sun and moon, in earth and sea and sky, a loud proclaim to all mankind that the coming of the Master draweth nigh. That's what we sung. That's what the song says. Signs foretold already in sun and moon, in earth and sea and sky. But there seems still to be a delay. But if that is so, what is causing such a delay? It's not a delay in the sun, in the signs. No. Can't be. Peter says, and our scripture reading, the Lord is not slack concerning his promises, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to usward, is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. Is not slack concerning his promise, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to us, is not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. God's long-suffering for us is a reason why he has not come long time ago. The servant of the Lord wrote in 1868, that's a long time ago, the servant of the Lord says, the morning is differ in mercy. Should the master appears, should the master comes, so many of us would be found unready. The morning is differ in mercy. Should Jesus comes yesterday, so many of us would be found unready. So God's unwillingness to have his people perish have been the reason for him not to come yet. But you think he's going to wait all these long times and still continue waiting? The church has been teaching and believe that In 1755, there was a great earthquake called Lisbon earthquake, and the church believes that this is a fulfillment of the prophecy of Revelation chapter 6, verse 12. The Advent Church believes that this is a fulfillment of a prophecy that the church has been teaching for centuries. Revelation 6, 12. The church has been teaching that May 19, 17, Haiti has been another fulfillment of prophecy. Not only that, but November 13, 1833, the church have been teaching that this is another fulfillment of prophecy. So it's not a delay in signs that Jesus is coming. It is just that God's people need to get ready and stay ready. Give the gospel a certain sound so Jesus can come. The morning is differ in mercy. Because if the master should appear, so many of us would be found unready. And so it is the duty of each of us to get ready, get our neighbors and families ready for the coming of the master. Get ready, get our neighbors and our families ready, because Jesus is still going to come. We are told that the angels of Revelation chapter 7, 1 through 3 has been holding. But how long? How long? How long? How much longer must God wait for us to be ready? Ready or not, Jesus is coming. The angels of God are holding the winds of strife. Holding. After these things, I saw four angels standing at the four corners of the earth. John says, that the wind should not blow on the earth or on the sea or on any tree. And I saw another angel ascending from the east, having the seal of a living God. And he cried with a loud voice to the angels to whom it was given to earth, the earth and the sea, saying, earth not. The earth, neither the sea nor the trees, till we have sealed the servant of God in their foreheads. So there is a waiting period that is now going on. And it's not going to be for much longer. Can't be for much longer. We got to reach the place now in our lives where we got to lift up the trumpet and loud let it ring, because Jesus is coming again. How much longer, beloved, must the angel of Revelation chapter 7 hold the winds of strife? They are ready to let go, but the church is holding them back. Jesus wants to come for his people. It grieves God's heart to see his children going through what is going on right now on planet Earth. He wants to come for his people. But we got to let him. How much longer, beloved, must the angel of Revelation chapter 16 hold on? Angels are holding. Wants to let loose. But we got to make up our minds We got to do something so something can happen. Beloved, the sins of earth have reached the nostril of God. The sins of earth have touched God's face. God wants to do something about it, but the church is still not ready. Sinners are still having a good time, playing around, while God wants to come for his people. Beloved, I trust today that God will help us by his grace to rise up, stand up, speak up, live up, so Jesus can come and take us up to live with him forever and forever. So many things are happening. So many developments are happening in our world. We need to give them all. Give them all. Give them all to Jesus. And he will turn our sorrows into joy. Sometimes it seems as if we are going through all the grunts of pain in this life. Very hard to bear. Under pressure. God wants to relieve us, beloved. God wants to relieve us. But those of us who have not surrendered ourselves to him, we are coming here day after day, Sabbath after Sabbath. God wants this church to surrender to him. When we surrender ourselves to him, then he wants us to surrender so he can use us to bring the gospel to the those who have not yet known him, so they too can come and be relief of the tensions that they are going through. And then they come and go and tell somebody else until the whole world is warned and know of Jesus' coming. Then Jesus will come to take his people home to live with him eternally. Beloved, it's time to go home. It's time to go home. It's time to go home. Isaiah says, come, everyone that thirsts, come. Come. And if you don't have no money, don't worry about it. Just come. Buy wine. Buy milk. Without money and without price. Jesus paid it all. All to him I owe. Sin has left the crimson stain. Thank God he washed it white as snow. We may not understand how it happens. Let's not try to figure it out. Hard to figure out because you just can't understand. He says, come now, let's reason together. Though your sins be as scarlet, I'll make them white as snow. Though they be red as crimson, I'll make them be as wool. How we do it? Don't ask me, ask God. But he takes the red blood, wash the red sin, and makes it white. I heard a preacher says one time that you're trying to find out God's mystery. Trying to find out how a black cow eats green grass and then gives white milk. You're trying to go into God's business, eh? And then the milk becomes yellow butter. God is just a mysterious God. God works the way he wants to work. He's God. And so though our sins may be as scarlet, he promises that he's going to make them white like snow. is God. He can do it. He knows how to do it. And so what God wants us to do is to get rid of our sins. Doesn't matter what our sins look like. He wants to get rid of our sins. Will you let him? The Savior is waiting to enter your heart. Why don't you let him come in? There's nothing in this world to keep you apart. Why don't you let him come in? Beloved, this world doesn't have anything to offer. Sin, shame, and disgrace. The devil is, the word of God in John said, the devil comes, the thief cometh to kill, steal, and to destroy. Jesus says, I come that they may have life and they may have it more abundantly. The devil in this world, he promises, as a matter of fact, he says, he is the ruler of this world. What he does to us is use us, abuse us, and then refuse us. Because he doesn't have anywhere to take us to. He doesn't have anything. He tells Jesus, all these will I give you. All what? All these will I give you if you just fall down and worship me. What did the devil have? Nothing. He lost everything and he don't want us to gain anything. So we can't afford to allow the devil's pressure, the devil's hell to become light. He got to bear every grunt of the fire that's prepared for him. So take the burden off your shoulder. Put it on Jesus' shoulder. Cast your cares, all your cares upon me. I say to you today, want to be ready when Jesus comes. Oh, I want to be ready when Jesus comes. Earth's pleasures grow dim while I'm waiting for him. Prayer is, Lord, keep us today till Jesus comes. Let us pray. God, our Father in heaven, we're thankful to know that with outstretched arms, you're saying to your children this morning, today, come unto me, all ye that labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you a rest. So this morning, Heavenly Father, in our hearts, we are saying, take me, make me wholly thine. Please, loving Lord, take us and make us your children today. Make us your people. Once upon a time, we were not a people. But now, we are the people of God. There was a time when we did not obtain mercy. But thank God, today, we have obtained mercy. Your song writer says, come every soul by sin oppressed, because there's mercy with the Lord. He will surely give you rest by trusting in his word. Heavenly Father, we pray today that you will help us to trust you. To trust you more and trust you more. Until we trust you and you take us to be with you in everlasting kingdom. For this, Heavenly Father, we give ourselves to you today. We are thankful that you have accepted us as your children. Please bless us in more ways that we can not even imagine. As we tell you thanks in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Have a well-spent Sabbath as we go to the remaining portion of today, Brother David. Let us be faithful and true to God. One of these days, he's going to come and take us home to live with him eternally.
Amen again, everyone. 442, how sweet are the tidings.
Amen.
Our Father in heaven, we are grateful to you for your word which you have given us. We thank you for the message today, Lord, preparing us for your soon coming. We pray for the messenger, Lord, as you empower him with your word today to give to your people. May we receive it with hope and hearts. May our hearts rejoice and be glad, knowing that we have a Savior who died to save us from sin. And he's coming soon to take us home to that great place that he has gone to prepare for us. May our hearts rejoice. May we be ready in such a time that when he comes, he will not say, "Depart from me, I know you not." But he will say to us, "Come, enter into the joy of my rest." May these words linger with us as we sit in our seat listening to your voice speaking to us today. May the Holy Spirit take a grip on each one of us' life as we go to witness to bring souls to thy kingdom, as we pray in Jesus' name.
Amen. Amen. Please be seated, everyone.